You know, he's drawing comps to guys like Cody Bellinger and Christian Yelich. So I guess we can pencil him in for an MVP award about 6 years from now. I think that's the guy they would really like.
And now swinging away, Wells hits a high fly ball toward the left field corner. Curtis right at the wall to watch it go fair and out of here.
Gotta be fighting that smile. First major league home run for Vernon Wells.
That was the first of many for Vernon Wells, who had an excellent career, predominantly with the Blue Jays. And why is he significant right now? Well, back in 1997, he was the fifth pick overall. The Blue Jays have not had the number five choice since then, but that's going to change on Wednesday when the draft comes around. You see the other top 10 picks of recent vintage. Felipe Lopez had a very good career, not mostly though with the Blue Jays. Ricky Romero was an all-star, and he was taken one pick ahead of Troy Tulowitzki back in 2005. Phil Bickford never signed. He's now with the Milwaukee Brewers, and Jeff Hoffman was eventually traded to Colorado for Tulowitzki. He never appeared in a big league game for the Blue Jays. So with a unique draft coming up beginning on Wednesday, we thought we would amass some experts, Shi Davidi, Ben Nicholson-Smith, and we're certainly happy to have Jim Callis from MLB.com with us. And Jim, let's start with you. Given that the men who will be drafted on Wednesday and Thursday haven't really played an organized baseball game in months and months, has the complexion of the projected first round changed at all?
Not so much. I mean, if you talk to teams, yes, they wish they had the extra two and a half months to evaluate players in actual games. But they do so much scouting the summer before with high school guys in showcases and college guys in summer leagues. And you got 4 weeks of the college season that I think the consensus for most teams is this isn't optimal, but we're in pretty good shape. So I think it's going to be – the draft will obviously be a lot shorter than usual. But I think for those five rounds that we do get, it will look like the first five rounds from a normal year.
Shi, let's focus on the Blue Jays. And before we get to predictions from all three of you about who they might take, how has this pandemic changed the way they've gone about their business preparing for this draft?
Well, there have been a few things there, Jamie. I mean, one is, because they haven't been able to go out and get fresh look, they've done a lot more analyzing the video and the data that they've had on the players that they're interested in much more depth. And because the rest of the baseball staff hasn't had a ton to do, they've been able to draw in people from their player development system. They've been able to draw in the big league coaches. They've been able to draw in research and development in ways that they otherwise might not have been able to, and really try to apply a more holistic view on a different players, try to get as much information and build up as much analysis of that information as possible. And so in using all those different resources, they're hoping at least that they can maybe counteract some of the drawbacks of not having those fresh current looks and not having that extra bit of time in which to assess guys on the rise or maybe guys on the decline.
Ben, let's get your impression, and let's begin with who you think the Blue Jays might choose with the fifth overall pick. A lot has to happen, obviously, in the first four, but give us a sense on where you think they might go when their choice comes around.
Well, it's a really interesting question. Regardless of who they get, they're going to get a very high-impact player, and I'm certainly no Jim Callis when it comes to making these predictions, but I'm going to point in the direction of Zach Veen. He's a high school outfielder, and he's somebody who has shown a lot of hitting ability already. He's very strong for a high school kid. He's got some defensive skills. So if you look at that combination, the potential upside there is immense. And I think if they take a high school player, Zach Veen is a name to watch for Blue Jays fans.
I agree with Ben. I think it's probably Zach Veen. He's the best high school prospect in this draft. He might be the only high school player taken in the top 10. Not because teams are conservative, because this is such a college-heavy draft. He can hit for average. He can hit for power. Chance to stay in center field. Probably more of a corner guy. He's drawing comps to guys like Cody Bellinger and Christian Yelich. So I guess we can pencil him in for an MVP award about 6 years from now. I think that's the guy they would really like. The team that could throw a wrench in their plans, though, I think the Royals like him at number four, too. And depending on how things shake out ahead of the Royals might get Veen at four before the Blue Jays can get him at five.
Well, back in 2011, the Blue Jays took Kevin Pillar in the 32nd round, and he had a reasonably good career with the club. And then 14 rounds later, they took Shane Farrell, who's now the director of amateur scouting, Shi. And I know you've spoken with Shane in advance of the draft. What impression do you get?
Very interesting and organized young man, and he very much is a young man. I mean, you think about a remarkable rise. I mean, you mentioned it less than a decade ago, he was a draft pick, and now he's about to select the number five overall player. But to me, what's intriguing is the Blue Jays have been a team that hasn't had a lot of risk in their drafts the last few years. They've been trying to be a bit more conservative, really done a lot more modeling work than they did previously under GM Alex Anthopoulos. And whether or not Shane Farrell continues that path built upon by Steve Sanders, who departed to take an AGM job with the Pittsburgh Pirates, whether he veers from that a little bit, I think that was going to be really intriguing to watch if Veen is available to them, because there's a trio of college arms that intrigues them afterwards. That would be the safer pick, one of those three arms. It'd be more in line with where they've been, and Veen would be a bit more outside their comfort zone. So this is going to be an intriguing call for Shane Farrell to make in his first draft in charge of the Blue Jays. And you know, one of the things that really lasted with me is this quote that he mentioned. And, you know, he said that, you know, you bet on the exception rather than the rule, and generally you're going to be okay. And I think if you look at that, I wonder if that might lean them towards a college arm as opposed to a high school outfielder if they have that choice.
Okay, Jim, let's expand on this notion of a safer pick. And maybe that's somebody like Max Meyer from Minnesota. The Blue Jays have reconstructed their farm system. Is it possible when you think you have a really, really good level of depth in your system already, it's easier to take a chance on someone like Zach Veen versus having to go a safer route with a college arm?
I think that really comes down more to your overall philosophy, kind of like Shi was alluding to, rather than the state of your farm system. Because even if you have farm system depth, if you believe in going the safer route, I think you're still going to go the safer route. I would suggest, and we don't know which way they're going to go, that if you're picking fifth in the draft, you know, it's because you had a really bad season the year before, and you should probably take whoever you think the best player is. It's funny because safe always feels like a pejorative to me, like it's a lesser player, but he's safer. And if they do go, say, the college route, and I do think Max Meyer is the college pitcher that they would target, and Nick Gonzalez is the college hitter they might target, both those guys are very talented players. So I think you could also argue, we have them both ranked, or we have Gonzalez ahead of Veen, we have Meyer right behind him. But those guys aren't necessarily safe, per se, like it's a lower ceiling. I mean, Max Meyer has two of the best pitches in the draft in his fastball and his slider, and Nick Gonzalez is a guy who led NCAA in hitting last year, home runs this year, and was Cape Cod League MVP in between. But, it'll be interesting. I mean, to me, and I know they're not asking me to make the choice for him, I think you've got to line – if you're picking fifth, you've got to line up the five best players in the draft, and you just simply pick whichever one is highest on your board when he's there.
So, Ben, five rounds will be completed by Thursday, and then unlike previous years, there will be thousands of players – who have yet to be selected in a major league draft because there aren't 40 rounds this year. What happens to those players?
Well, it could lead to some really congested college classes in the future. I mean, if you're a freshman thinking of going into college, your opportunities might be limited by the presence of all of these college players who might ordinarily have been drafted, but in this year they won't be. They'll be returning to college. So it will have an impact not only on this summer when, you know, we don't know exactly what the minor league season will look like, but also going into future years.
Shi, what do you know about Canadian content in the first two or three rounds?
Well, the shortened draft has definitely going to be an impact or have a significant impact on Canadian players. But for the three players at the top of the draft in terms of Canadians, they're probably going to be okay. Owen Casey is a hard-hitting outfielder, left-handed hitter, who some Blue Jay fans may remember as the player on the Canadian junior national team who hit a home run against the Blue Jays during their annual exhibition game in spring training. You know, he's got a chance to be the first Canadian taken, you know, big time pop. He's really made a lot of progress in the last little while. You know, I've heard suggestions that he could sneak up into the second round, probably in the third round, if not. And that'd be a great spot for him. And you know, certainly he's at the head of the class. Another Canadian outfielder from the junior national team, David Calabrese, very speedy player, a chance to be a good defender, chance to stick in center field. You know, he's going to be up there as well. And then there's one collegiate player, Jordan Nwogu from Michigan, a hard-hitting outfielder, has a bit of a funky hitting stance. You know, he has a little hitch in the with his legs that I think for some people may raise some questions. But he's had a big impact on the Michigan program, come up with a lot of big hits, has some pop. And I think those three guys are going to be okay. It's the Canadians beyond them in this draft where there's going to be some impact. And a lot of Canadian kids who were maybe thinking they had a chance to start a professional career, they may be headed to college instead.
Jim, the postponement of the season to this point has robbed Blue Jay fans of seeing an infield made up entirely of second-generation players. So it would have been Travis Shaw at first, Bo Bichette playing short, Kevin Biggio at second, and Vladimir Guerrero Jr. at third. And I always love watching the draft to see whose sons, or grandsons in some respects, are being drafted. What do you know about second or even third generation players being available in the five rounds?
Yeah, you know, in terms of guys who are going to go early in the draft, I mean, you got Tyler Soderstrom, who's a high school catcher, third baseman from California. His dad, Steve, played briefly in the big leagues, was a number six overall pick. Bryce Jarvis at Duke, who threw a perfect game this spring and almost threw a second one. He's the son of Kevin Jarvis, who pitched a long time in the big leagues. Those are the two who jumped to mind right off the top of the draft. I mean, you'll see, I mean, there are names, but, you know, obviously with only five rounds, there won't be as many of those guys. A lot of teams like to draft, you know, somebody's son or relative in the 32nd round, so we'll have a lot less of that this year.
Well, Jim, since we have you and we know your expertise is in scouting and analysis of prospects and certainly ranking farm systems and such, I must ask while you were here, do you get the impression there will be a baseball season of some kind this year?
Well, I don't have any inside knowledge on that. I mean, I keep getting asked that. My standard answer is I'm trying to stay optimistic about it, even though all the rhetoric leaves not much cause for optimism. I guess in the end, I mean, the way I look at it is neither side's going to get a deal they're going to be perfectly happy with because that's going to be impossible. But I've got to think that both sides realize that they're better off playing games, not playing games. I mean, I don't buy into this notion, oh, they must play for our entertainment. We must have this. I mean, this is a business negotiation, but I can't imagine how either side would think, you know what, we don't like this deal. We're just better off not playing. So I think we will have a season. I have no inside knowledge. I guess we'll find out soon. But yeah, I'm trying to stay optimistic.
All right. Our thanks to Jim Callis of MLB.com and to Shi Davidi and Ben Nicholson-Smith of Sportsnet. Everybody at home, hope you're safe and healthy. And thank you for watching Blue Jays Central at home.